impressive does not do it justice. And UCLA, to their never-ending credit, is actually returning to the field for the second half. Total domination statistically by Oregon, the nation's number one scoring and offense in terms of yardage, 357 yards. Reasonable minds can differ about who really number one is, but Oregon certainly made its case in the first half. The
most impressive thing for me was 16 of 20, 220 yards by Darren Thomas. And they did not get to Thomas. Again, this offense has given up two sacks all season. If you can't stop the pass, that run's going to just crush you. It's great balance.
The impressive thing to me for Oregon has been their ability to handle the big stage. Everybody wondered how this team would respond now having the targets on their back, number two in the BCS, number one in the human polls, and they're out here putting on an offensive clinic.
Second half is underway. Josh Huff returning the kickoff. Huff's got great speed, and he's tripped up just across the 30.
If you're wanting to get in the coaching business, go ahead and go to Home Depot and find this offense right here. This is going to be called give and take. You give it this time to LaMichael James. The next time you take it from him, because that's what the read told you to do. That's what this offense does. It takes what the defense gives them. And then, again, when Thomas can throw the ball like that, Jesse, that's how do you think about stopping it?
Guys, this has to be the first time that our coaching adjustment has been don't make an adjustment. Just keep doing what you're doing.
Huff on the pitch. Another first down, big gain that moves the chains immediately for the Ducks.
Josh Huff is one of only three true freshmen that have even seen the field this year for Oregon. He's averaging over 15 yards every time he touches the football. You got to be special to get on the field your first year out of high school. He's one of those guys.
James with his first carry of the second half. And LaMichael gets it down to the 45-yard.
You guys are just talking about no adjustments from Kelly, but actually I talked to him coming out of the half, and he says, believe this, they're actually holding the ball longer than he would like. He thinks Thomas needs to get the ball out quicker, so that's his adjustment coming out of the half.
Again, Jesse mentioned he'd been able to go to his second or third read. Rolling to his left, another completion. Now 17 of 21. Lavoisier 2-8. The coverage was by Raheem Moore.
This is easily the best I've ever seen Darren Thomas throw the football, whether it's been in the pocket, whether he's getting on the perimeter. I wonder what the Lee Corso play is.
The Lee Corso, Carl the groundskeeper combination play. That, I would say with Carl the groundskeeper, it has to be explosive. It's lucky they're not going against Minnesota when Carl the groundskeeper shows up. He did not have an affinity for Gophers.
Well, this UCLA football team would like to find a groundskeeper. They'd like to find someone with a photograph they could borrow to stop Oregon's offense. I mean, when you look at what they've done, 21 of those 42 plays, and they just get it going. They don't let you breathe.
And Kelly won't be satisfied. I mean, you cannot count the number of times he screams tempo at practice. Thomas got a man. Paulson couldn't hold it.
There's just no pressure on Thomas. And this ball, the throw, what a fantastic.
David Paulson got away with a one-handed catch earlier in the game. That's one he needs to get two hands up to secure the catch. Can't get cocky.
Did the guy not have his arm holding it down a little bit?
Looks as if he could have. This is the only thing the Ducks didn't do in the first half, convert a third down. Oh, well, so much for that. Now they've done that, too.
RD, pressure's on you, buddy.
I don't know. Hey, you know what? Chip Kelly said it. Pressure is when what you feel when you don't know what you're doing.
Well, I see your wife infiltrated Oregon. They've got War Eagle.
Thomas.
All right. That was the Reese Davis play, by the way. Almost picked.
You wait. I'll get you back. Michael James getting inside the 20. It'll bring up third down for the Ducks. Thomas on third down is complete. Davis has it.
They matched up. He thought they were motivated to come in here tonight. I don't think he anticipated this game getting out of hand like it has so far.
James inside the 5. They're going against the juggernaut right now. Thomas, end zone, touchdown, Jeff Mayo, delivers again.
256 and three touchdowns. LaMichael James is a deserving Heisman candidate on this Oregon team, but Darren Thomas is stealing the show. Beard on for the extra point. And the Ducks have 39 on the board. Duck, I'm going to tell you, the chest muscle is going to be sore from all the push-ups. UCLA sore from getting steamrolled. Third touchdown pass of the night from Darren Thomas. Men in yellow are rolling. 39-3. Oregon has scored on all six possessions tonight. Five touchdowns and a field goal. Touchdowns by five different players in the Bruins. Trying to get it back. Damian Thigpen returning to kickoff. Now the Ducks are swarming on special teams. John Blackman has to be the leading contender for the Blitnikoff right now. Brijo's first pass in the second half.
Another great example on that touchdown by Darren Thomas getting through his progression. He's going to roll out to the left. He's got a slot receiver, 2-and-a, running a return route. But the second read is Jeff Mayle working the baseline. He gets through it very quickly, makes a very accurate throw, rolling to his left.
Jonathan Franklin is drilled. Josh Padu. Here comes some pressure. Bruins pick it up nicely. Brijo trying to run for the first down. Richard staying on his feet and fighting his way. Prince injured, not dressing tonight. He's had a knee problem for much of the season. It's cost him a lot of practice time. Brijo avoids a couple of duck rushes, but can't avoid.
He's learning as he goes. He's inexperienced. He's getting this experience firsthand tonight.
You have to look at Prince on the sidelines. I said he wasn't dressed. It's what we've been told, but he is not going to play tonight with that knee at all. Franklin bursts into the secondary. First down for the Bruins up to midfield. On first and 10, Coleman's back in. Brijo has to get rid of it. Heaves it up. The flag flying.
Pass interference on the defense. Number 13. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Cliff Harris is a guy that has a lot of upside, and they're trying to work right now. Nick Aliotti, the defensive coordinator, just to teach him the little things of the game. You know, getting the hands on a receiver down the field right in front of an official, you're probably going to get called on that.
But, you know, Harris is a guy who has enormous talent. He took two punts back against New Mexico to tie a Pac-10 record that has stood since Mike Garrett played for USC in 1965, the former Heisman Trophy winner. But Harris is a guy who has that cornerback attitude. He's a guy that Aliotti has a great deal of regard for. He's trying to help him develop, and Nick works conform as Brijo goes up top, throwing for the end zone.
Offside. On the defense, number 58, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
We'll go back to Harris for a minute. Harris has four interceptions already this season, that's second in the nation, but he's really just now earning his first start. He's got that attitude and the confidence you like. When he showed up here, and I'm going to paraphrase because there still might be some kids up someplace, he introduced himself to his teammates by saying, "I'm Cliff Harris, and I'm here to lock
expletive
stuff." Well, I was going to say stuff. Down. And so he's had to sort of conform with the system, but he's a guy that they're very high on, and Aliotti really thinks he can be a tremendous player in this Duck defense.
Well, Nick Aliotti will tell you he's a bit of a dinosaur in the sense that he wants his players to conform. He wants them not to be me guys. He wants them to be we guys. Until Cliff Harris does more of that, he won't play as often.
And he thinks that Harris is moving in that direction. Brijo throwing on second down, short completion. Ducks 11th in the country, as you saw a moment ago on third down. Now they'll try to keep the Bruins from getting 2 yards. Franklin, first hole, wasn't there. And Ty Forbath is going to try a field goal. He is only 6 field goals short of the NCAA record. Time from about 49, easily within his range and, well, within his accuracy. Josh Huff will return the kickoff. Huff gets it out close to the 30-yard line.
Keeps the ball.
Michael James loses his footing as he gets close to the line of scrimmage, he'll lose a couple.
Which allows Landry from a powerful team. I mean, it's, and they're young. They're just going to get better.
Thomas up top. Mayles out there. Mayles got it.
And if you can't get lined up, you got no chance to play defense.
Thomas needs 2 yards for a 300-yard passing game. This is for the nation's third-leading rushing attack. He's got it. 300 yards, Mayles on the catch.
How about Jeff Mayles, a guy that played safety his first 10 games as a freshman for Oregon? They moved him to wide receiver, and he's been Mr. Consistent the last 3 years now catching the football.
He put on weight so that he could become a better player, a stronger player. He's dependable. I really like Mayles.
Oh, it's batted down from Thomas. Mayles, when he was 12 years old, his dad was on a fishing trip and he told him he couldn't play football. He slipped around and tricked his mom into letting him play. But Michael James.
That opened up a huge gap.
On the defense, number 11, penalty declined, first down and goal.
Well, Darren was over there looking at the official like, what did we do? And the answer was nothing. It was on UCLA.
And I'm just so impressed with this offense at the tempo they run without making as many mistakes as we've seen from other high-paced offenses.
That's the problem with these gap offenses, right? They just zone block. They let the running back find the hole.
14 now career 100-yard games.
Already tied the school record. This just in his 17th game. Thomas is hit right in the face. Ball is batted around and goes in. He's got freshman defensive ends in UCLA. He's been a little confused by the speed tonight. This guy can confuse you. LaMichael heads for the pylon. He'll be stopped just short of it. It'll be fourth down.
Well, you know, Jess, I think if you kick a field goal here, that's running up the score. I mean, you know, you might as well just run the play. You don't really need the points. Just work on the play.
Thomas can throw it. A flag comes down.
Holding. Number 42 on the offense. Penalties declined. First down.
On UCLA, Bruins with their first defensive stop of the night. Holding Oregon on fourth down. But now, Richard Brijo on the offense will put it in play. Their own three. Brijo throws it out of his own end zone. He's got his man. It's complete to Randall Carroll. Certainly didn't confirm the exact reason why. He said the worst repercussion you could have is to have somebody sit out a game. And he said what they had to do is Rio was throwing it down the middle and looking for Anthony Fong. All right, John, Derek Coleman being swarmed under. You saw the National League Championship Series, the American League Championship Series, a particular athletic family. He's chosen football and he's junior. Has four catches on the season and none tonight, but he's help the Bruins run it a little bit at times. Brijo's holding too long. Ball's on the ground. Looks like the Ducks have it.
Showing you that inexperience here. Understanding when you're down inside your near your own end, third down, ball's got to come out. And if your first receiver's not open right away, you immediately got to look for a check down or you got to throw this football away.
Two guys that aren't on that UCLA offensive line. Xavier Suafilo's on a Mormon mission. Well, Michael James goes in for a touchdown, another academic ineligibility, and another with an injury. The extra point.
Offensively happy to take advantage of a sudden change situation. Another simple zone read play. The offensive line doing a great job opening up a scene for LaMichael James on yet another score.
Sitting at 500 yards. On the dot for the night, and we are not yet through the third quarter. That's about 67 yards short of their nation-leading average. Bruce Davis, Greg James, Jesse Palmer, and Jen Brown with you, seeing an impressive display from the number one team in the polls, number two in the BCS. Damian Thigpen's been busy returning kickoffs tonight. Getting late in the third quarter, UCLA has it back. Rio throws it out of bounds. You know, the Pac-10 today announced the new divisions that will come when Colorado and Utah join the conference next year.
And not that this will be the indication every year, but probably say the UCLA is probably glad that they are not in Oregon's division because they're not going to play the Ducks every year. And I know it'll be different. I just wish this could have happened a little earlier, not had to show up here tonight.
I look forward to watching Utah play in the Pac-12 and see how they handle it.
It's interesting to see the effect this has on recruiting kids from Southern California. If you're playing in that North Division, you don't get a game in South California every year. You're going to play one of those teams once every other year. It'll be interesting to see how that affects it.
Riho throwing for Marv Ray, catches in, a flag is flying. You know, guys, I talked to Larry Scott about the interdivisional scheduling. The one thing that will happen for the schools in the Pacific Northwest, and it had been a stumbling block, they wanted to play the teams from Southern California every year, as we get the call on the penalty here from the
ref. Pass interference on the offense, number 82, blocking downfield, 15-yard penalty, still second down.
Well, the one thing that is going to happen when the Pac-10 becomes the Pac-12, division play, going to the conference championship game, you'll get a game against one of the schools from Southern California if you're Oregon, Oregon State, Washington, Washington State. You just won't necessarily go there. One of the schools will come here and play against the teams up here.
I think that it caught my attention was the fact that whoever has the best conference record will host the championship game, not a neutral site. I like that. I think that rewards and encourages you to get after it during the conference record.
The division champion with the best conference record. What happens all of a sudden if you have an Oregon team that's 11-1 and a USC team that's 11-1? Then where does the game go?
You continue to bicker.
You know, I asked Larry that too, and he said it would probably wind up looking at the BCS standings. That would probably be who would get the home field advantage in that case.
Larry Scott being the commissioner.
Right, the commissioner of the Pac-10 who has really shepherded in a change. UCLA continuing to fight. Larry Scott back in the summer, who was very aggressive in terms of expansion, going after Texas A&M, Oklahoma, Oklahoma State, trying to expand to 16 teams, but still they've expanded their footprint. You've got a conference championship game now, and really as the landscape and the structure of college athletics changed, the Pac-10, now the Pac-12, soon to be Pac-12, sort of gotten a step ahead.
I'll tell you what, Colorado and Utah, adding them, I think that's a real plus. A very strong, solid conference continues to get better.
Rio needs 15. Arkey makes the grab. He'll be well short of the first one down. Holds. Oregon up 46-6. Their duck has done a lot of push-ups tonight, getting himself ready to work out with Craig and Jesse. What in the world are the boys up to tonight for a workout? You'll be able to see momentarily.
What are you stiff-arming me, man? You want to carry me,
too? You're going to jump. I barely hold the duck.
Come on.
I was looking for a little love and a ride.
Cliff Harris.
Harris, not much on the return.
Guys had to score from the Oregon strength and conditioning guy. And you know what, Jesse, I think we agree. This warm-up exercise, I was sore this morning. It really stretches you out pretty good.
And they do a lot of speed work here. They had these speed ladders. This crushed me. This absolutely worked out my stabilizers on my shoulders, which was awesome.
Chop, 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 chop.
Yeah. So they do a lot
Look
of work.
Look at the footwork, the base, the great base.
And moving the sled, working the core.
Oh, man. Well, Duck's still working on that latest set of push-ups, 46. Now, it looks as if Darren Thomas's night is over as Nate Costa checked in at quarterback. Nate getting some heat and runs away from it.
We're talking about power, getting feet up, putting them down. One thing for certain, these Oregon football players, they know where their feet are.
Costa leaves it with Remine Alston. Alston inside the 40, still on his feet.
Early in the first quarter, Alston comes in, got a carry or two, but you see that the fresh legs and the offensive line still getting out there. Big number 70 had him a block there, ran some Gopalson.
Costa. Nate Costa driving inside the 5, and the quarterback who aspires to be a Secret Service agent. Alston looking for the end zone touchdown. 27-0 back in 1929. They're going to set a new record here.
From that series, there was the second group that's in there, the second quarterback, The ball's across before anything. Is that they scored in a minute and 5 seconds.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Play results in a touchdown.
And he's been wearing earplugs to try to help that equilibrium along as he continues his recovery. Ducks have been able just to send the next guy out there, and 53 more push-ups coming. The one-hand variety just to make it a little more difficult, I guess. Oregon, easy time up tonight, up 53-6. Damian Thigpen stopped short of the 25-yard line. Duck being passed around. Bruins going to Malcolm Jones for a short game. That certainly worked, but the unintended consequence has been the detrimental effect, they say, for spending so much time putting in the pistol and the option version of it. Jones goes nowhere. Rio has some protection, throws it in. Taylor Embry, good route, good catch. That play put the Bruins over 100 yards passing, which exceeds their average, but a little bit more suited for this pistol-style attack. And the offense may continue to evolve. Rick said, wants to always be able to throw and catch, and they just haven't done it effectively this season. Rio does have a completion to the freshman Malcolm Jones out of back. Rio, another completion. This one to Anthony Barr. Barr gets down to the 30. Another first down for the Bruins. Jones is stopped immediately.
Keep in mind, Oregon has not given up a point during the fourth quarter all season long. So, if there's anything to look for a positive if you're UCLA.
They've given up only 104 points all season.
Probably amplifies USC's passing woes better than anything. The 130 yards is a season high last year. In a different offense, Kevin Prince had three consecutive 300-yard games. Rio has to get rid of it and throws it over the head of his intended receiver, Christian Ramirez. Rio in trouble, and he has to throw it away. It'll be fourth down and 10.
Oh, Nick Aliotti there in the middle. He doesn't want to give any more fourth quarter points up. He wants to keep that goose egg there.
Call it the House of Loud. Oregon up 53-6, and still the fans are into it, trying to help stop UCLA on fourth and 10. Richard Rijo throwing. It's incomplete, and the Ducks got to stop. Oregon putting the boot to UCLA's throat, 53-6 in the fourth quarter. Ducks have it back after stopping UCLA on a 4th and 10. The Washington has been a little rainy in the second half of this game. A Costa in a quarterback for Oregon. He completes his pass out in the flat. That's Darrell Hawkins making a grab. Last night, Chip Kelly invited us to come by his team meeting at the hotel the night before. We got a chance to really see how Chip, just in his second year as a head coach, interacts with his guys. And there are some guys that really know how to captivate their players in a room and get their message across. And he had unique and clever ways of getting messages across to his team. Here's a run from Austin.
I was into it. I mean, you know, we don't get to go to a lot of team meetings, but Kelly did have the attention of his players, and he starts talking about, you know, this not giving up and being focused in a boxing match, and this is the seventh round of a heavyweight fight. And he put a video on of a ninth round major fight, boxing match, of two guys just pounding each other.
It was Irish Mickey Ward and Arturo Gatti, who had three epic fights, and one of those fights really was a candidate for fight of the century, and he had that ninth round on. We talk about the season being a 12-round fight.
After the play, there are two personal fouls. 43 on the defense, number 70 on the offense, penalties in the offset. That'll be two.
When you're watching the ninth round of this war between Mickey Ward and Arturo Gatti, I mean, it is just that. It is a slugfest, drag-out battle. And he comes back up when the video's over and starts talking about Irish Mickey Ward, grew up 20 minutes away from him back in Massachusetts. And then he says, you know what, I can't tell the story that well. Let's get Mickey up here to tell it himself. three doors down from us, Irish Mickey Ward gets up, goes to the front of the class, starts talking to the team.
Hawkins on the quick catch, and Ward's message was one that really echoes and amplifies what Chip Kelly always talks about being relentless, never giving up, no matter how many times you're hit, just refuse to go down. And they had the visual, they had the videotape of the ninth round of that fight against Gotti with those two guys just wailing on each other, and everybody was into it, and the players really received the message. It was a creative way to kind of capture the imagination of your players.
Ward told them to keep their chin down. Everybody's going to be coming after you as your number one. And if the guy's telling you like that, to keep your chin down.
They write down things they'd like to do when they're head coach, but a lot of guys have a little more trouble implementing them. Now surpassed their yardage total in terms of average. Came into the night averaging about 567 yards per game, 584, and the Bruins have a false start.
False start on the offense, number 10, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Not much is going right tonight.
Think back on the first quarter, Reese, they came out running the ball effectively, but again, no points in the first quarter. I mean, they got 14 all C. I mean, they just can't score early and they get behind.
A few plays away from being undefeated.
Oh, two plays, really.
Yeah, absolutely. Way back in the national championship race because of that, and eligible for the postseason. And it certainly played into the fact that maybe Barclays Brijo just gets smashed from behind. It's picked up. It's going to be a fumble. It is Marvin Johnson who's trying to get in the end zone.
Now, this is just the backside. Now, we have seen this several times tonight. Richard Brijo just not getting rid of the football. That internal clock not inside him, not ticking tonight.
That's Brandon Hanna, the backup left defensive end. We talked about the depth they have on offense. They got a lot of that on defense as well. And because they rotate up to 24 guys a game, they're able to stay fresh. They're coming right at you as fast as they were in the first quarter. They're bringing in the fourth quarter.
Tell that his arm was going forward. Every play in college football reviewed. They've had a look at it. Not the case. Ducks keep it on the ground. Walston diving for the pylon. No signal. Yeah, it looked like a touchdown. Now they give it to him.
On the outside and extend the body and the ball.
Chip Kelly having a coaching moment right now with Remini Alston. He gets him over to the sideline, starts pointing at the replay, and he says, hey, you had a lane to run through in the middle. Why would you bounce that outside?
What happened? Is it six?
That's what you would have said, Coach. It's in the house.
Well, I would tell you, the coaching point might also be take care of the football on first down, because that was very close to a touchback, too.
You see Chip Kelly kind of looking at him. Hey, now, where are you going on that? We're trying to run that thing inside. Why would you bounce it outside?
But he's patting him on the back, too.
See, more.
Points.
And here's another point that he's doing. He's trying to tell his team, I know you're good. He's going to have great challenges coming up, making sure he can keep his team focused and on task for the season.
And what he encourages guys to do in the meeting where we were last night was not to worry about playing well enough to beat somebody, but to play to your standards. Try to be as excellent as you could possibly be, to do as well as you can, regardless of who the opponent is. And I would say that the Ducks have certainly at least come close to that goal tonight.
So is this guy here. You talk about play regardless of the opponent. I thought the 16 for 20 in the first half, the passing, the success, two touchdown passes early. Thomas just never got rattled and showed incredible composure. I think we've now seen a quarterback. This is his team.
I did not think Darren Thomas was a good passer when he didn't have play action. He had really struggled this season when he was forced to drop back and make a throw downfield into coverage. Well, he changed my opinion tonight. Deadly accurate, getting through his progressions, keeping plays alive. The best I've ever seen him look.
Well, he is tonight's Wrangler five-star player of the game and well-deserved with a career-high 308 yards passing. Brijo's pass complete to Corey Harkey for a short game.
And I tell you what else he did well. Not only did he throw it well, he has to make decisions when he's running the football. That zone read and when to give it, when to take it, how to make calls at the line of scrimmage. Again, Chip Kelly has taken his quarterback and he's taught him football, how to run his offense.
Well, boys, wonder if something's going to happen this weekend in college football on Saturday.
Oh, they were looking for the number one in the polls to go down for the third straight week. Not happening here.
You think Brett Bielema's maybe calling some guys up, telling them how to do it?
Well, maybe so. It's you know, I think the biggest challenge for Wisconsin now is trying to avoid the fate of South Carolina.
Oh, hey, only three penalties a game. Wisconsin's got it going. They'll have a little confidence coming off that.
Going to take on Iowa in Kinnick Stadium on Saturday, and certainly Iowa a much different challenge than South Carolina had going in against Kentucky. But Gamecocks blew a big lead, couldn't finish the deal. See how Wisconsin, how much gas they have left in the tank when they go to Iowa.
Curious to see a Nebraska team on the road at Oklahoma State, where they haven't won since 1995. Brandon Weeden, second best in the country in terms of passing yards per game.
There's Malcolm Jones. Option football on the ground. As if the Bruins fell on it.
That's why I ask you guys the question. What's going to happen Saturday?
That's right.
You never know.
It's the beauty of college football.
Breho gets rid of it. Has a man wide open. Ducks make the tackle inside the 10. It's Randall Carroll. It's significant now in under 2.5 minutes to go. Breho. Richard Breho into the end zone, touchdown Bruins.
So UCLA is still trying to get its program
2 weeks. You can't look past Northwestern.
And the computers will look at Northwestern as a good football team. That's a good win for Michigan State. Should spark another one of those games that supports the concept that these automatic qualifier conferences really have to gear it up and play every week, every Saturday.
Guys, I was curious tonight to see how Oregon could handle the target, being number one in the human polls, number two in the BCS, the national stage. You know, Chip Kelly's attitude about playing faceless opponents, never talking about rankings, has been very impressive. You know, he's a guy that earlier said, look, we're the defending Pac-10 champions, so it's not like we weren't going to get everybody's best effort anyway.
Yeah. You know what else I noticed on this thing today, too? This offense is so powerful, it blows up the opponents and their thinking, their mindset. The offense on the other side of the field center thinking, hey, we got to go tit for tat with this thing, and it's just going to be hard to do it.
And that's the sign for Scott Van Pelt, who's going to read the highlight for the Oregon-UCLA game, I'm sure.
What do you like better? Which one? Photo, top left, bottom left.
I know why you like bottom. I know why you like bottom left.
Love you, Scott.
There it is, top left, bottom left.
I'm a fan of the bottom left also.
What's wrong with gusto? Nobody's giving gusto anymore. And the Ducks remain undefeated, 7-0 for just the third time ever. And Jen Brown is with the head duck, Chip Kelly.
Hey, Coach. Thank you very much. Hey, Coach, big game from Darren Thomas tonight. What did you like about your quarterback play?
Just his poise, didn't turn the ball over, exactly what we asked him to do. We knew we were going to have to throw the ball a little bit because of how tough they were on the run defense, and he did a great job.
You had five different guys score on offense. What does that say about your versatility of your team?
We're pretty balanced, and in that we got a lot of different guys besides the Michael James, who I think is one of the best in the country. So, you know, it's another one on us. We got a couple days to rest, but we have a huge game coming.
Defensively, you were able to shut them down and hold them to just 13 points. How were you able to do that tonight?
You know, I think our defense is the unsung hero of this football team. They've kept us in every game. They play really well. And as the game goes along, because we play so many guys on defense, we can wear people down.
You talk about looking ahead. You've got a dangerous USC team next, coming off of a bye week. What do you expect from that game?
We expect everything. You know, I've got so much respect for them. I think Matt Barkley's one of the top quarterbacks in the country. They've got a lot of weapons. They got a young receiver, Woods, who's outstanding. They got great running backs. You know, we think it's going to be another tough Pac-10 battle, and we got to play on the road, which is really hard in this league.
Thanks so much, Coach. Reese, back to you.
Not tonight. Team from Los Angeles, no match for number two Oregon, 60-13, the final. Sports Center's coming up next. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Jen Brown, our entire excellent Thursday night ESPN crew, I'm Reese Davis saying good night from Austin Stadium, the Ducks 7-0.